All right, Mr. Manager.
All right, Mayor, members of council. I'm going to do an agenda review for you, overview, and then we'll jump right into it, which is I've got John Stevenson, your senior transportation engineer, is going to do a pop-up, give you a quick update on some quick actions on Hampton Boulevard and Princess Anne Road that we've been having a lot of conversation about. Jim Reddick, emergency operations manager, is going to come up and talk to you about Florence, after action report, and we'll talk about this a little more when he gets here. But obviously, a lot went on that week. We were blessed that the storm didn't come here, but we prepared as if it were, and frankly, we learned a lot, and I think we'll be better prepared for the next one, and he's going to explain that. Jessica Dennis, management analyst, is going to come back and talk to you about the scooters, e-scooters, and we've got a recommendation for you to go out for a proposal on a pilot program. We'll talk about your council calendar, so we want to get you to adopt that next week, and I think we've responded to some of the issues and concerns, and I'll talk to you about the principles we used to set that up. And then Richard Broad is going to come forward and give you an update on recycling, and then we will go into a closed session for a couple of real estate items. So with that said, I'd ask John to step forward. John Stevenson, your senior transportation engineer, and obviously we've heard a lot in the last few months about Hampton Boulevard and Princess Anne Road in particular, and we've had some conversations at your retreat, and then again in the meeting in here about exactly what's happening on Princess Anne Road, particularly in the short run. But I want him to just want us all to see it and be clear of what's happening. So John, if you can step forward. And
all right. Well, thank you very much, Mayor and City Council members. Pleasure to be here. Just give you a couple quick updates on some significant highway safety projects we're currently working on. First one's Hampton Boulevard. Has to do with some long-standing concerns with the area residents regarding speeding and other pedestrian safety issues along Hampton Boulevard. Probably the most impactful recommendation that we're going to be making is for some lane reductions on Hampton Boulevard in the vicinity of the Bowling Avenue intersection. This is a location where earlier this year we had a tractor-trailer, unfortunately, that flipped over right in the middle of the intersection. Could have really been a hazardous situation. So as a result of that, what we're taking a look at is taking measures to reduce the speed levels and improve the safety through the curve of the intersection. That includes doing the lane reduction, going from 3 lanes to 2 lanes in the southbound direction, widening the lane slightly, not too much to increase speeds, but just slightly, and also improving the geometrics of the radius through the curve, again, to help navigate the vehicles through the intersection more safely. We've had a number of Civic League meetings we've attended. We've attended 4 already. We've got Larchmont Civic League coming up this coming Thursday evening. And then we have 4 more that are either scheduled or tentatively scheduled for January. All right. Next. And the next one is Princess Anne Road. This is initiative to try and improve the safety for pedestrians as well as... I'm sorry.
This is a portion of what we're recommending, but we're recommending more than this.
That's correct. This is probably the most significant recommendation.
So these are the things that are going to happen in the near term. You've got the Hampton Boulevard Committee that's going to come forward with a series of recommendations. But this is going to happen fairly quickly, and we just didn't want to get ahead of you, get ahead of the community, and wanted also, because we've had the conversations about this signal at Princess Anne, I wanted everybody to be real clear on what we're doing and what we're not doing.
I understand, but with regard to this, we've had a series of meetings, so I just want to just distinguish between what we're talking about with regards to this and a broader several elements of Hampton Boulevard. This specifically is distinct, and it's going to happen no matter what. Is that what you're saying?
No, it's still a recommendation. We're going through the public outreach process. It's something we feel very strongly about to help improve the safety through the network. It's part of the reason we're recommending this action now is, as you may well know, Hampton Boulevard is going to be resurfaced coming this spring, and we see this as an opportunity during that resurfacing program to make some lane marking improvements with that resurfacing project.
So this would start at what point? At the southbound side of the bridge?
Well, it's a combination of things. It really would begin just south of Bowling Avenue in the northbound direction, all the way up to potentially the foot of the Hampton Boulevard Bridge. Coming southbound, it actually would be quite a bit longer because of
how we want to reduce and affect the speeds of traffic coming over the Hampton Boulevard Bridge. We're actually talking about reducing the travel lanes, getting right around Glen Eagles, start the transition and reduction of travel lanes in that area.
And this is only in the southbound direction?
This one just happens to show southbound. It'd get a little too cluttered if we showed northbound direction as well.
Okay, so this is more extensive than the photo.
Quite a bit,
illustrates.
Yes.
Okay, it's what we're hearing otherwise. I just wanted to distinguish between what we've heard in the committee meetings versus what we're seeing here, because it's a little more extensive. And
absolutely.
Okay.
All right.
They are going out, as the last note points out, anyone watching online, they're going to all the Civic League meetings and doing presentations. I was lucky enough to attend one earlier this week, and y'all are doing a fantastic job taking input from the citizens. So it's
thank you.
And it's more extensive at the Civic League. You're going into more detail.
Yeah, quite a bit more detail, absolutely.
And the Larchmont meeting is December 20th?
December 20th, correct.
Okay. That'd be a great meeting for folks who are interested in this to come.
Absolutely. We're definitely encouraging. The Civic League president is really putting out a good notice, so we expect a good crowd.
Sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry to...
No, I appreciate the clarification.
...want a little more detail.
All right. Again, the next one is Princess Anne Road. This is, again, really an initiative to try and improve the safety and the motor vehicle access in and around the Richard Bowling Elementary School and the Jordan Newby Branch Library. Short term, we're looking at actually doing a traffic signal at the intersection of Princess Anne Road at Majestic. This is really based on some input from community meetings with Broad Creek Civic League and some conversations with the community as well. This is just really the short-term approach. We're actually looking at having a longer-term, broader review of Princess Anne Road corridor, or as well as the Virginia Beach Boulevard corridor. We actually have a consultant on board. They're already doing traffic counts and studies on both Virginia Beach Boulevard and Princess Anne Road. So we expect to come up with a really broad initiative for that particular area. This is a quick response, something we've done in-house, and we're going to have our indefinite quantity contractor actually do the construction as opposed to going out to bid.
So John, be real clear on what the signal is in the short run. It's not the way Winter explained to me, not really all that different from what happened at Waterside Drive while we were waiting for that pole, call it a year ago.
Right.
So explain, because it was unclear. I think some folks are, you're saying traffic signal, and they're picking up a big black pole, arm coming off of it, new pole, which is takes longer, more expensive, but what... Describe what they're getting into.
We're doing a little bit of both. It's actually going to be a full intersection. I think in the early talks we talked about doing something different that would just be for pedestrians, but based on conversations that we've had and actually observing the school operation, we realized that that was probably not the best thing to do. So we're actually doing a full-blown traffic signal with pedestrian improvements. It'll be pedestrian signals, and actually when the pedestrians will be crossing the street, none of the vehicular traffic will be moving. It's going to be what we would refer to exclusive pedestrian phase. So that's really to improve the safety at that particular location. We're actually going in with a temporary installation for the most part, which is going to be wood poles. Some of the infrastructure will actually be permanent because we can do that now, but we're going with wood poles right now because for the traffic signal displays themselves, because the lead time for the signal equipment is anywhere from 20 weeks to 38 weeks. So we felt that was just way too long to wait, and so we're going in with the wood poles at least temporarily until we can get in with the permanent project.
All right.
Questions?
John, thank you. So just because we've got a lot of conversation, just wanted some clarification, and particularly on the second one, in that I know we've had speakers at different times, and frankly, I think I misled you all at the retreat on what was going to get put up, and so I just wanted it to be really clear on what was going to get put up in the short run and what's going to be up in the long run. All right. So with that, I'm going to ask Jim Reddick to jump up, and as I said, we had the Hurricane Florence, and I'm going to give you the after-action report, and look forward to any conversation or insights that you all have as well. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, sir. Mayor, members of council, Mr. Smith, thank you for the opportunity to share with you some of those highlighted lessons learned from Hurricane Florence. As many of us are aware, Kim, can you go to the next slide, please? So to piggyback on what the manager said, we had all of the storm and really none of the impacts. So the storm came, it went, and in a lot of places that would be considered a non-event. But that's not so for here. Those of us here in Team Norfolk, we see it as not a non-event, but an opportunity and more so a responsibility to really identify what exactly went right and what those areas of improvement are. And we do so under a microscopic lens to the point where it almost seems like we just did a bad job. And that's not the case at all. I want to emphasize all that we had done correctly, those strengths on which we can build, but certainly where those areas of improvement can be made. Next slide. So anytime we're doing disaster response, there are the five key areas through which we work. Number one is obviously command and coordination. It's the leadership aspect, the strategic vision, really implementing those things that we want to accomplish throughout the incident. And then number one is always life safety. And then we look at the infrastructure. Public safety doesn't stop in bad weather. And then if we're not keeping the community informed, then we're really not doing a great job in terms of responding to the incident. Kim. So looking at command and coordination, what I try to do with these slides is on the left-hand slide, show those strengths, those things that went right, and on the right-hand side, those areas of improvement. And I'll tell you up front, a lot of the areas of improvement, they aren't technical issues, they aren't resource issues. We're blessed to have the resources that we need. We just need to come together to make sure that we come together with a combined solution. So the collaboration, teamwork, Team Norfolk, it is what it is. It's a successful practice. We work very closely with Dr. Boone, Norfolk Public Schools. The Sheriff's Office was a fantastic partner. We work with the largest employer in our area, the Navy, as well as our higher education partners and so many other folks. So the teamwork, the collaboration, we collaborated very well, and we collaborated often. The physical location where a lot of that took place is in the Emergency Operations Center, and Mr. Smith made a decision early that the EOC in which we usually work on Virginia Beach Boulevard was not going to be appropriate or sufficient for this type of storm heading our way. So he made the call to go to the third precinct. Best decision made. Again, we did that early. And if it weren't for Stephen DeBerry and his folks, information technology, working day and night for at least 48 hours, if not longer, they made that work. Because if we don't have the ports, we don't have the communications equipment, we don't have the technology there, then it's going to be more of a primitive emergency operations center. We can't reach out to the partners with whom we work. And with that was improved situational awareness. We had that improved situational awareness in the emergency operations center, but also through use of technology and more basic technology in terms of conference lines. Team Norfolk is more than the amount of folks that we can fit into an emergency operations center. So our briefings were conducted in person and through video conference calls. So the partners from HRT, from Dominion, Virginia Power, from Old Dominion, Norfolk State, all of them were on our conference call so we could share what situational awareness we had and what situational awareness they had, and we can all work together towards those common goals and objectives. So the areas of improvement are awareness of citywide plans. We have excellent plans at each departmental level, and sometimes we can refer to them as silos of excellence, frankly. The plans were followed, the SOPs were followed, but we have citywide plans that were adopted by this body showing more of a catastrophic scenario, how all of those resources can come together to really respond to any disaster in the most effective way. And part of that planning is the gap analysis and prescripted request. So knowing exactly what do we have on hand, is it serviceable? If we don't have it on hand, is it something that's available through our partners throughout the region? Is it a resource request? Do we invest in the equipment? Would it be worth sustaining those costs? Or do we simply have a prescriptive request in our battle rhythm that if these conditions are met, we automatically request these things from the state? So we're working through that process right now. That improved situational awareness I mentioned, there's a program we used called HISN, the Homeland Security Information Network. The bad thing is I didn't do much training about HISN or awareness of that tool was prior to. So we have been working with Homeland Security and the folks from HISN prior to this storm for several weeks, trying to figure out if this is a new product that we would really like to leverage. And Florence was a great opportunity to really kick the tires on that. We made it work, but obviously without folks having true awareness of what it's capable of doing, accounts were an issue and everything else. A lot of areas of improvement have been identified there. greater commitment to the incident command system, and we've talked about the incident command system and its overall program being the National Incident Management System on really, again, something this body adopted in 2005 as our formal system to respond to any incidents. We need to do a better job on that. Again, like I put on the bottom of that slide, that's on me. I need to prepare or provide a scenario of catastrophic planning, and I need to do a lot better in terms of planning and training on what the incident command system is. The incident command system, if you're unfamiliar with, I mean, the planning piece alone is what makes it worthwhile. That allows us to be more proactive in terms of a disaster response instead of reactive. Likewise, logistics, it allows us to leverage what resources we have and go through one section so we can leverage and maximize all of Team Norfolk's resources. But we also need that commitment from partner agencies. So if we're going to have shared goals and objectives, and we have a timeline by which we're going to restore services throughout the city, we need to make sure that everyone is on board with that and there aren't any agencies acting independently. It's got to be a one team, one fight mentality. And we can establish that one team, one fight mentality regionally as well. You have been briefed before about regional solutions and a regional response to disaster. That's something else that we had focused on and something we're going to continue to build on for future events. Next. So like I said, the number one priority for any disaster is always life safety. So we have mass care, health, and human services. Know Your Zone sticker was proven to be a best practice when the governor designated or called for the mandatory evacuation. Our 911 folks were slammed, and they did a fantastic job. However, we would have received a lot more calls if we hadn't put the stickers on everybody's trash cans. So that work, which was done between my office, Richard Broad's office, the folks doing waste management, and some of our volunteers from the Navy and Community Emergency Response Team all got together to make sure that everybody had stickers on their trash can. So when the governor made his mandatory evacuation order and the state's website went down, we could tell folks simply just check out your trash can. And it worked so well. Yes, ma'am.
Are we gonna re-look at those trash? I don't think I ever got a sticker. I've got two trash cans. I never got a sticker on my trash can.
Okay.
I knew my zone, so it wasn't an issue.
Sure.
But, you know, trash cans get beaten up and taken through the ringer. Are we going to re-sticker?
Yes, ma'am. We can do that right now, in fact. We have put out
I wouldn't do it right now. I would wait until the summer.
Sure.
So it's right before a hurricane.
Exactly. Right.
But I'm just saying, just that it should be an annual thing to do in, you know, hurricane prep season, which probably was July, August time, right?
Sure. So yes, we will do an annual checkup on that. But in the meantime, folks can simply call the Norfolk Cares Call Center. And if they say they don't have a sticker on their trash can, we'll schedule a time to get it out there. A nice blue sky.
Is there also a better way for people? I never paid attention to the sticker.
Okay.
So, but I knew where I live.
Because you don't take out the trash.
That is true. I never paid attention to the sticker. And there are a lot of people didn't pay attention to the sticker. So when you said that there was a sticker, there were a lot of people who didn't know what you were talking about.
Sure.
And so I'm just wondering, is there another way that we can help people help themselves so that 911 is not, because if 911 is slammed with West My Zone, mm-hmm. 911, it makes it so when if somebody's dying, that call is taking longer to get processed.
Sure.
If people are calling asking, what's my zone? So how can we help our residents better understand what zone they're in and then what that means in terms of evacuation?
Okay.
When we're, you know, when we have these kind of mandatory evacuations.
Sure. So I love the question. I will say that there are two prongs to the response. One, Lori and Marcom had done an informal survey after the storm about who evacuated, what were their decision points and stuff like that. And likewise, Old Dominion is doing a more scientific study exactly of, you know, what were the hindrances about the stickers and everything else and what goes into an individual's decision. So we'll have some more data on which to craft new messages to make sure that the messaging can be as effective as possible. And the other piece, and I kind of mentioned it on the right hand towards the bottom, is neighborhood inclusion. To quote Jerry Maguire, help me help you. We can give the message all day long, but people have to want to receive it. And so when we go out into the community, and we have some exciting things scheduled with Michelle Johnson, Neighborhood Development, where we're partnering together to go out into the community to meet people where they are. So they don't necessarily have to attend a special event anywhere. We will come to them. But so often, and we've seen this body in particular, we'll have events where we have more staff than people attending. And so we have to work on how we can attract folks to actually attend these meetings so we can give them this critical information. We will hold it whenever, however, and however often.
Okay, so could you possibly do, since most people's attention span is very short, maybe a 30-second or 45-second video that's posted to social media? The other thing that I know we've asked for several different times is when y'all post stuff like that, can you tag us in it? I mean, we said this like four or five, I know we've had this conversation like four or five times that I can remember, because we reach an audience oftentimes that this somebody may not be tuned into the city web, the city Facebook page or the city Twitter. So if you tag council members who are active on social media, you also get a whole nother audience of people, especially if you're trying to get survey information or if you're trying to get information out there. And so I don't know what has to happen to make that happen. I mean, if we have to sign something or whatever, it's fine. Yeah, but if we, and then, you know, it just helps to get it to, because we're engaged personally with citizens, and so it helps us to help you to get information to people who need it.
Sure. So you just quoted Jerry Maguire to me now. So, okay. So, yes, ma'am, consider that done.
Let me help you.
That's an easy fix. Yes, ma'am.
But a video would help. I mean, and then with a link or whatever. I mean, because people's attention spans are small.
Sure.
Or short, rather. So you can, you know.
Okay, I'm the perfect model for that. So I'll get that for you.
Councilman Smigel?
Sure. I don't want to poo-poo the stickers, because the people who are going to looked at them, and the people are, it's like any other communication. It was just one extra thing that I think we did, and it helped for the people that were going to utilize this. I want to keep them going, because I think for those who do take out the trash, I saw the sticker, so I knew my zone. And I know there's some corrections that we need to make, because one of the state maps was different than our map in East Ocean View area. But my recommendation, because everybody looks at their water bill, is to somehow put it on the Harubs bill as you get closer to it, where they can see it. Just says, and I know that the billing on Harubs sometimes goes to a different address, but all it is a statement on there that says this is based off of your physical address, you know, on that. So, but particularly many elderly people that still get a bill and do it that way. So, I mean, I pay online, but I still get a physical bill because I have to check it to make sure I'm not getting billed incorrectly. Sure. But people look at those Rubs bill, and I know they do because of all the emails we get from people complaining about the cost of it.
None of us do. I'm just saying it's a good okay.
So once again, just another form of communication. It's just like we go to civic leagues all the time, but we know there's a whole group of people on next door. It's just another mode of communication with people, and that's a free thing. I don't think we pay to have a message printed in Harubs. I think that's we get a certain amount of messaging we could do. It could just be a slip of paper that goes in there based off of the address. So.
You know what? If you put it near the amount due, people will pay attention to that. You put another slip of paper in there, they're going to probably be looking for their bill and not paying attention. But if you put it, you live in zone one and your amount due is, people may, they're going to pay attention to how much they owe.
I think we're belaboring the zone issue, and it's just a lot more what you're talking about here. I think it's really important, but, I'm worried about, are we training our staff in advance of an emergency to actually staff the emergency shelters? I'm worried
about
what happened.
So we weren't. But right. We did. We scrambled that literally that week.
So fortunately, we didn't have a lot of folks in our shelters.
He's going to walk you through.
Yes, ma'am. So great transition. Real quick, there's no reason why we couldn't put them in the bills. And if it's online banking that you do, having on the website for HRSD and Harubs, I mean, we can make sure that there are high-tech and low-tech methods to communicate before, during, and after an incident, because we know that some folks aren't reliant on technology. So we do the best we can throughout the whole spectrum of communications. So yes, everyone that presented themselves at a shelter was sheltered. So we could say, done, we knocked that out of the park, but we didn't. So we know that there were lessons learned, that when the governor said mandatory evacuation, some of our staff who works in shelters said, nope, we're out. We live in evacuation zone A. You know, we're going to beat feet. We're going to take our family somewhere else. So that whole process of not only identifying who's going to be next on those shelter workers, communicating to them early and often, even at the beginning of hurricane season, and then providing the necessary training to make sure that they can do that is something that we're looking at. Also, Deputy City Manager Catherine Weitzel had led an effort to look at opportunities where we have a task force, if you will, those folks who are interested in working in a shelter, making sure that they're on the, not only the first on the list, but again, the most trained and most qualified folks to provide that type of accommodations in our shelters. I will say meals and snacks, again, Norfolk Public Schools, fantastic job providing meals that they had in their inventory for those shelters that were in our schools. Mercy Chefs, fantastic. Again, meals that they provided for those who are in our recreation centers, and American Red Cross coming through with snacks to make sure everyone is well fed. Wi-Fi in our shelter had been a cantankerous issue in the past. We had that. Verizon Wireless stepped up at no cost to make sure that our shelters had Wi-Fi capability. Again, this is all about Team Norfolk. And then the data analysis, again, Stephen DeBerry's GIS team did a fantastic job. Information that we would receive from the state, usually in the form of a spreadsheet with just a lot of data, they were able to do their GIS magic and turn data into information that provided some excellent analysis for not only the response efforts, but for future planning as well. Yes, ma'am.
The shelters were city buildings.
Yes. Well, so some shelters were schools and some were recreation centers.
So we have schools and recreation centers that don't have Wi-Fi?
Well, I think it's more of the Wi-Fi is there, but it's more controlled as far as who has access, administrative rights, and everything else. So it was actually easier and able to accomplish what we wanted for that Wi-Fi area.
But like we have rec centers that don't have free Wi-Fi?
Yes. Yes.
Why?
It's a huge issue.
It's not inexpensive. Is
I can address they're not in most rec centers. We're looking at that. They are pretty expensive to do that, but there's some other alternatives.
Okay.
Agreed.
We need to talk about that. Because we send kids there to do homework and stuff, and they need to, anyway.
Okay.
Kicking
the soapbox. No, we'll follow up that, and that'll be in our after action. And another thing in our after action is the medically friendly sheltering. Again, this is a challenging issue that we've faced for so long because no one particular organization department can handle it. And those to whom we would typically look are able to provide different types of sheltering, but this is going to have to be a team solution. And the equipment, again, the equipment's there. So those who require more than basic first aid in a shelter, but not to the level of hospital care, we have equipment that was purchased through Homeland Security grant dollars to provide that type of accommodations, realistic accommodations. Perhaps a solution is working with some of our private partners, and we're working with Lake Taylor, having those discussions, as well as Bon Secours, Sentara. Or perhaps the solution is regional, and we have scheduled conversations with Virginia Beach, who uses the field house, a very large facility where we might be able to partner on that. So there is more to come on that. I'd like to say that there is a promising future in that area because it's been, again, a challenge for several years, since I've been here, in fact. And I think there's a solution on the horizon. So there will be more to come on that. Sir. Yes, sir.
Jim, can you tell me about the NEST program? I got some feedback from a church recently about when an event happens, whether snow or whatever, that because it's on a rotating basis, that church may end up getting stuck housing the NEST program for extra longer period of time. And if it's a snow event, clearing the church parking lot, and the recommendation was that could there be a more centrally city location, maybe like the bottom of Scope or something, that you could house during those period of times where you may have ice for a week or something, that could be better service rather than a church that may end up getting stuck with that. And I don't know if that's true. It was feedback that came back from one of the churches. Right.
That's a great question, and it is true. And one of the challenges is also the logistics of moving folks back and forth to between day and night. And so we're looking at this point, and I don't know if this is on your list, of perhaps one of the rec centers just being
a location. Rec center, okay.
Then,
yes.
Yeah,
yes.
So okay. We skip that. But yeah, it's a, yes, it was a an issue for us, and we think we fixed it.
Yeah, and then if it happens to be at a church that's on another side of the city, right. Trying to get right. Everybody there can that's be an issue. Okay.
So, sir, since you mentioned it's not part of this briefing, but I have to give a huge thanks to Operation Blessing. Because Ann O'Dell, who is coordinating the logistics, busing, and everything else for this year's NEST program, they were essentially without busing accommodations. They had lost their bus contract, and the private sector contractors who might have been interested, the prices that they were giving was something that the NEST program could just not meet. So in conversations, we're meeting with Operation all the time, Operation Blessing all the time, and they told us that they are very interested in helping more in the community, and more specifically, our residents experiencing homelessness. So I went with them with an ask. No expectations. I said, you know, I know this is part of your mission. I know this is part of your interest. Here's our need. And they have given us, through a grant, over $15,000 to assist us with busing for this year's homeless population in the NEST program. So they deserve absolute thanks. And again, without them, we probably wouldn't be as successful as we are so far this year. So in terms of the special needs sheltering, it's a great transition into the STIR initiative, and Ms. McClellan is very aware of this. We were able to put in for a proposed project for pre-registration, letting folks know exactly what the accommodations are going to be in whatever shelter. And again, whatever shelter we open will be dependent on the incident itself. But here's the shelters and here's the accommodations that they can meet. So if we're able to identify who those folks outside of the homeless population who might be going to these shelters, we can communicate to them what the accommodations are, what the rules are, and likewise, we can ask them what special accommodations might you need. And that way, we can plan even better and really speed folks up through the registration process if they're able to do that online. So that's something that we're working with the STIR initiative, and hopefully we'll have some more outcomes from that. I already mentioned the unified restoration of services. We have to make sure that we're all working with the incident command system. And I mentioned the great work that I'm really excited about with neighborhood development and Michelle and her folks. Next, Kim. Infrastructure. So this isn't something that we were able to observe through this incident. Primarily, again, with all of the storm heading our way, we made all the necessary preparations for sheltering and the human piece. Infrastructure, I can tell you, and Richard, hopefully keep me honest, adherence to the plans, policies, and procedures were down. They do that. They do it very well, whether it's a winter storm or a hurricane or a nor'easter. Their folks are out there. They're out there clearing drains and ditches. They're going to do trash pickup until they can't any longer. We opened up parking garages, as did, again, Old Dominion University opened up 5 garages for us. And working with Norfolk Public Schools, they opened up a lot of their parking lots as well. So finding folks parking safe havens for their vehicles so they don't flood is something that we do very well, I think, every time. And again, big thanks to ODU, Norfolk Public Schools, and our partners for helping with that as well. The Safe Store. If you've never heard of the Cape Rise, I need to take you on a field trip to the Cape Rise. It is a very big vessel. It's over in Portsmouth, and they accommodate a lot of our equipment. And when I say equipment, I don't mean generators. I mean vehicle equipment. That vessel is not going anywhere. It's not going to be disturbed by the wave activity. And they provide this service at no cost to the localities throughout Hampton Roads. So I'll just, if I can, Kim, if you can just go up one slide, just to give you a few pictures of what that looks like. Again, this thing, when you go into that main first deck, your equipment will be put on an elevator and taken to one of at least 5 or 6 different decks on that vessel. So again, our vehicles can be safe during the storm and then retrieved right afterwards in great working condition and brought back to Norfolk to go back to work really quickly. Can you go backwards one more? So one thing, again, this is on me, is the logistical needs for field personnel. We need to figure out, and right now it's every department to determine what they're able to provide for their staff, the staff on whom we're going to rely on for response and recovery. So whether it's a base staging area for them to sleep, for sheltering, or for food, that's something that I think we can collectively get together and work through to have a unified plan throughout the city. building access when city is closed. That should simply be an addition to our continuity of operations plan that says if this building's going to be closed because municipal operations are paused, then these folks will have access to that facility. Align the generator availability with resource reliant on power. So we've already started working with Nikki Riddick and the General Services to determine what generators we have and what those needs are for the different pump stations, equipment, or vehicles, or facilities to make sure that we can marry them up. And whatever that nexus is, work with our partners to see how quickly we can get a generator, along with understanding what the fuel makeup is, the fuel type, all that stuff. And then trash pickup marketing campaign, letting folks know that Public Works is going to continue picking up trash and recycling as you know, immediately or as long as possible. And I'm sure you've heard enough briefings to know whether it's winter storm or hurricanes that's the number one question to the city is, when is my trash going to get picked up? So we can do a better job communicating that out to the community. And likewise, one thing, one more thing that I need to do is not only communicate what a catastrophic incident looks like, but really try to find out from the departments what their pinch point is. And Mr. Smith has said that a number of times. What is that point by which you can no longer operate with your own resources? And so, again, with the catastrophic storms that have been out there, there's certainly studies, after-action reports. So you might recall the 9/11 Commission report where they said that there was a lack of imagination, lack of creativity. That shouldn't be the case for us. There's been enough storms that happened before us that we can set a firm foundation of what a catastrophic incident looks like. And then really through that gap analysis, you know, approach each department to say, okay, we understand that you have these resources and commodities for this type of incident. Well, what about this type? And then again, from there, really pushing the envelope to figure out exactly what we can do and then where we need to rely on others. And then public safety, I'll breeze through this, which is unfortunate because our police and fire partners and the sheriff's department and 911, they act superbly before and during and after an incident. We did find, again, a fantastic partner with the sheriff's office staff in our shelters to augment what we had because obviously the courts aren't going to be in session. So we really worked with the sheriff to determine how we can best work as a team for that incident and then henceforth. So again, fantastic partner with the sheriff's office. And then lastly, public information. We made excellent strides in the press conference that we did, the first press conference that we've had, particularly with a sign language interpreter. Again, as we make sure that our messaging to the community is timely, actionable, accurate, and accessible, making sure that we have sign language interpreters is exactly what we need to do, because otherwise we're going to miss a significant segment of our population. Kudos to the Norfolk Cares Call Center. They worked 24/7 throughout the incident. And the Joint Information Center, those folks, Michael Brown, Lori Crouch, their team of MarCom, really came together to work out their hot sheets and really collaborate messaging from various partners. So it was a one voice for this one team. Lastly, the TV AV technical issues, which were expected in a new EOC environment, which Stephen DeBerry and his folks overcame. We're just going to invest in more, knowing that that's going to be the new EOC location for now on. Knowing where to put telephones so folks don't have to run across the room. Better coordination with the Virginia Department of Emergency Management for their press briefings, because they would have some, and we wouldn't always know about it, so we would have to try to follow up that way. And then defining what mandatory evacuation means. That's a challenge as well, especially if it's something that's not going to be or cannot be enforced. What does mandatory evacuation mean? Or what other words might be necessary to really communicate the threat, the severity, instead of, you know, we strongly encourage you to evacuate. So with that, Kim, moving forward, commitment and to constant improvement. We are always looking for that next opportunity to improve. And we know that the issues that we have are primarily human, not technical or resources. So again, Team Norfolk, we're all about working together and we'll be able to achieve a lot of this. And I'm looking forward to coming back with you with a report on all these things that have been accomplished. This will result in planning updates and revisions. Those are already in place. And then we're going to continuously train and exercises, and would love to have you be a part of those training and exercises as well. So with that, Mr. Smith, I'll turn it over for any questions.
Thank you, Jim. So, Mayor, members of council, unfortunately, the severity and frequency of these incidents is just increasing. And so we're getting better and better, but the intensity gets greater and greater. And so I think part of the maybe the main message here is this one pushed us a little harder than some in terms of resources and the time those resources were out. And you saw on that last slide, we had some, you know, we can get through a 2 or 3 day incident with some people that really kill themselves. What we learned this time was we sent some people home and we brought some newer, younger people in and then taught them how to run the show and how to do that piece. And this will be a constantly evolving, constantly learning exercise. But Jim, I appreciate the update.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Joe, one of the things I think we need to do is probably have this as a retreat topic so that we can spend some quality time on something as comprehensive as this. We didn't get a chance to talk about residents who may be on medication or need assistance, 24-hour medical assistance in our shelters, what type of capital that's going to require, more about the collaboration and coordinating with external agencies, what resources may be needed in the future. This was a good drill, good planning, but there's a lot that we didn't get a chance to talk about, and I think that I would like for you to bring this back at a retreat so we really can do a deep dive to really understand how we will respond in the event there is a need to really have multiple shelters and a lot of residents in those shelters to be sheltered for an extended period of time. What does that look like? And are we prepared to handle an event and, you know, citywide? Okay, I saw Tommy, then I saw Mamie.
So, Doug, I don't want to jinx you.
You
but
usually
I want to talk
do.
About snow. We dodged a bullet this week with big snowstorm. At the last discussion about snow, I had suggested about putting signs up on our primary and secondary routes. That's something that we could create in-house that marks where those roads are, and that also there needed to be a little bit of tweaking to those primary and secondary routes that were being cleared. After some other changes were made that we were, and I just, you know, we're going to see an increase in the amount of these events as well. So we're going to have a snowstorm probably this winter. Yeah. I just want us to be ready for it. And as we move into the period where we're not meeting as much again in the wintertime, I just want to make sure that we're updated with any changes and improvements that you guys may have made. The tax increase included some money for new equipment that I think you guys were going to buy a few extra snow plows as well as part of that. So a good update on that. You don't have to do it now, but something for us maybe in a follow-up would be helpful just as we start sharing that, because I wouldn't have been ready for this snow event if it happened. I was watching that snow line come so close to us. Glad we didn't get it, but it's bound to happen. All right, got it.
Maybe then Courtney.
I just had two things in reference to the snow. Mm-hmm. Number one, I know that council some time ago requested a list of the primary and secondary roads, if we could possibly get those, because we did have some discussion concerning that, and we wanted to know why some roads were considered primary and others weren't. Mr. Reddick, you mentioned shelter training. Ms. Lori Crouch, you put out, I think today, shelter training 2019 classes. Is that what you're
it's
referring to?
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
That's what I want to know. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Lori, what was the number the first time that went out? How many, that was voluntary. How many folks signed up?
It was packed. Yeah. We had to turn folks away. Right. So we've already done a couple of classes and this will be the next round.
Following up on Tommy's conversation, I also would like to see what are we doing to collaborate with our regional cities, because the snows don't end at the borders, so we need to keep going down Princess Anne Road and Virginia Beach, or we need to keep going down Military and Virginia Beach Boulevard. What are we doing with our sister cities so that we're plowing successfully for many and not just truly stopping at the borders?
The general consensus in the past, Courtney, has been that probably Virginia Beach needs to come into Norfolk.
Well, that's
because
fine.
Ours at the border is where it kind of gets a little crappy and getting into Norfolk. So that's
where,
just kind of been the consensus.
Whatever the direction
the
may be, so it doesn't end at the border. So I think can we do a better job collaborating?
And you remember the last year we were fortunate, at least in the early part of the storm, we got a lot of support from VDOT in those first couple of days, which makes a big difference. And if you remember that storm, a follow-up storm came to the west, and we lost all those, all that support. So without the VDOT support, it puts a real burden on us to keep the primary roads.
We still pay VDOT. We pay them.
Oh, yeah.
So my question that last time was, is it just better for us to spend the money on our own contractors or equipment instead of relying on VDOT, who pulled out and left us hanging?
Right. It's an interesting question. I mean, they've got the obviously the resources. They've got the equipment. We've talked about the fact that it's difficult for us to buy substantial extra equipment. As you said, we did set up to where the new vehicles we bring in will have the ability to put a plow on, that sort of thing. So I think we'll have more assets.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Next. All right. So, e-scooters.
So Jessica Dennis, management analyst in the city manager's office, is going to give you an update and a recommendation of a pilot program and an RFP that we'll put out as quickly as the end of the year, if you all are in agreement.
Good evening, City Council, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Manager. I was last year back on October 9th, and at that time gave a quick briefing on the situation regarding scooters in Norfolk and promised that I would return with a final recommendation, as Mr. Smith mentioned, which is why I'm here this evening. So really quickly, I'll refresh all of our memories. Since last time we talked about this, it was in October. Then jump right into what staff's recommendation is, and then give you insight into how we got here and some of the case study cities or example cities we've looked to throughout the country as we came to this decision. And then close up with some next steps. So just as I mentioned, refresh everyone's memories. Starting August 29th, Bird began dropping their scooters into our right-of-way without authorization. In response, staff from the city attorney's office and the right-of-way division reached out to Bird to communicate regarding ways that Bird could legally operate in our city, and the requests for documentation were not fully complied with on Bird's side. So in response, our right-of-way staff has continued to collect and impound scooters as they've appeared. When I was here on October 9th, we had about 400 scooters in our possession, and that number has since grown to 520 that are currently impounded, though I do not think we have collected any recently. Is that correct? Thank you. Yes. And so also during the same period of time, staff assembled a work group that consisted of various city departments as well as some of our community stakeholders who are also impacted by scooters appearing on our sidewalks. So those stakeholders included Norfolk State, Old Dominion, Downtown Norfolk Council, and Elizabeth River Trail Foundation. It's possible I forgot something, and I do apologize to any organization if I did forget you. So the purpose of this group was to help identify some of the considerations we needed to look to as we developed what we thought would be a good path forward for scooters. So some things we looked at were the public safety component. If scooters were introduced into the city, where could they safely ride? Should there be restrictions for riding at night for visibility purposes? And also education and communication. How do we inform our residents who both want to use the scooters and who also don't want to be negatively impacted by them what the expectations are? So closing that up, presented some of those considerations during my presentation on the 9th and promised to come back with recommendation. And as Mr. Smith alluded to, staff's recommendation at this time, should you wish to move forward, is a one-year pilot program with a vendor or vendors selected through an RFP process. If we move forward, staff sees this pilot program beginning sometime in the spring once the weather warms up, and it's more likely that people would be willing to scoot across town. The RFP process is the same that we engaged to bring in our existing bike share partner, Pace. So, and this is also, issuing an RFP gives us the opportunity to outline what we as a city see as necessary components for a program such as this. So some of the items I mentioned before, public safety, education, and data sharing, and recognizes that we as city staff may not be industry experts in what is admittedly a very new industry. And so RFP gives the opportunity for vendors to bring to us what are some of the more cutting edge things that they can bring and help us structure what is the best fit for Norfolk, both to enhance our existing multimodal transportation system while also preserving our responsibility to provide safe access to right of way for all of our residents. So as you can see at the bottom of the slide, with your authorization to move forward, we would issue an RFP by the end of the year, with the goal to select a vendor sometime over the winter and roll out the pilot in the spring. And the reason I say vendor or vendors, we're open to one or more depending on what is, feels like the best fit for us. So how did we get here? And as I mentioned, staff did not do this on our own. We partnered with other organizations in our stakeholder work group. We also reached out to other cities across the country. This is not a new problem just for Norfolk. This is something new that other communities across the country are trying to find the right balance for providing a service or amenity to people who would like to use it while also ensuring safe use of this amenity. So through these two avenues, we came to the conclusion that our goal for whatever we came forward with as a recommendation had to find a way to complement our existing transportation network, but also preserve our duty for public safety, which is why a pilot program seems like the right fit for this. It gives us opportunity to evaluate whether this makes sense. Is this actually an amenity that residents and visitors use in our city, or does it become more of a nuisance and is not the right answer for Norfolk long term? 1 year gives about the right amount of time. We go through all seasons to see what utilization is, and if it were to become a long-term program, is it something we would want year-round, and how do we adjust for changes in weather conditions or as in extreme weather, and how our vendor responds? As I mentioned, a pilot program is not an abnormal way to engage the scooter community. Many cities across the country have done this. And for the exact same reasons I've mentioned, this is a testing ground, and it gives opportunity for flexibility. In Virginia, Charlottesville and Arlington County have rolled out pilot programs. I believe in a news article released yesterday or today that Harrisonburg is considering a pilot program during their council meeting this week. And Richmond, I know, has proposed and discussed a pilot program, but as of my last research, I don't think it was adopted and rolled out, and so I think it might still be pending. So that leads me into some of the case studies we looked at. I mentioned we reached out to other communities, and I will say this is just a sample of some of the cities we've looked to. This is, across the country, a new technology that many localities are trying to figure out and integrate into their existing systems. So to start off with, I'll highlight Arlington here in the Commonwealth. It is, I believe, the farthest along in their pilot project, though not by much. They are at the very beginning of a 9-month pilot project. It began this fall, and they have authorized 3 vendors to operate in the city: Bird, Lime, and Lyft. And right now, the county is engaging in a community outreach campaign to educate both residents and potential users on what the e-scooter technology is capable of, but also what this pilot program consists of. Next, Austin. Austin is at a slightly different place. They have gotten to a point with their shared mobility program that they're actually using the data they've collected to begin creating a regulatory framework for responding to the different issues that arise, such as where do scooters park? Do they want scooters to be in to utilize their sidewalks? How fast can scooters go in different parts of the city? Do they wish to restrict scooters or allow them on some of their recreation trails? That's been a new pilot program introducing scooters to various recreation trails in Austin. And also out today, the Center for Disease Control announced that they will be conducting an epidemiological study in Austin to look at the impact of scooters on safety in the roadways. So there have been a few reports of vehicular accidents involving scooters, and that question was raised within our internal work group, but also among other localities. Are these safe? Is there more of a safety factor than we realize? And the feedback we've gotten thus far has been, with the way that 911 calls are called in or police reports are filed, it's not always clear if it was a electric scooter involved or how an accident occurred. So with this study, hopefully countrywide, we should get a better answer as to, is this more dangerous than we think it is? So finally, I'll highlight Santa Monica, California. I mentioned in my October 9th presentation, it is the hometown of Bird, and so therefore seen as kind of ground zero for electric scooters.
And they just rolled out a 16-month pilot program, and their goal is to, something unique about theirs is they have what they call a dynamic capping system. So through that, they will use performance metrics that they have communicated out to all of their vendors, and that will dictate how many vehicles any one time those vendors can have in their city. And so the performance metrics they're looking towards for allowing scooters are the vendors' maintenance, education, safety, customer service, and data sharing. So should we move forward, of course, staff will continue to monitor what these programs look like in the cities and what data comes out of them, because this isn't a static environment. It's changing all the time. And the lessons learned from these cities are helping inform us, and hopefully if we move forward, some of the advances we make in our city could help dictate future pilot programs and others. So our next steps would be for you, City Council, to decide if you wish to move forward with the pilot program allowing scooters in Norfolk. And if so, we will definitely use the data collected to provide regular updates. And I'll open up for questions.
One thing I would ask, if we decide to move forward with the pilot program, the data that you're going to collect, I know that you will collect traffic infractions, maybe information from our first responders if there's a collision. But what about interviews? Interviewing people who are enjoying the scooter and so to get that data analysis and get an interpretation, because if you just only collect when there's a collision and there's traffic, infraction or some code enforcement, that's what you would bring us.
Yeah.
So what's your methodology? Engagement? What's your methodology of getting, being holistic and being global in your pilot program?
So we definitely would have quantitative data that we would collect, or that the vendor would collect and share with us. So number of users, where they're using, and that type of stuff. But one interesting component of the Austin program that I think would be beneficial for us to translate over here is part of the data they're using to inform their regulatory process is community outreach. They've done community meetings where they've collected feedback. They've also conducted an online survey. So collecting that and doing it in a slightly more scientific way than just, comments on a news article, actively and intentionally reaching out to our community and seeing what the feedback is. Is our community using it? Is it our residents who are using it? Or is it people who are visiting and that type of
thing? I think that qualitative data, that experience will be very helpful. So before, if we decide to do this, what are you asking us to approve? Do you have, you showed the case studies from other cities.
So if you go for, if you all agree that you want to move forward with this as a transportation alternative for us here in Norfolk, then we would put out a request for proposals to see who would come in for a 1-year pilot, whether that's one vendor or more.
We'll bring you back to us. Okay, so Andrea, then Angela.
So I have no problem. I think going forward with a pilot RFP is a great idea, but I don't understand the details. I mean, are they going to be allowed on sidewalks, bike lanes? Any street, only streets of 25 miles an hour, helmets required, not required.
So that's part of that proposal. What is the proposal?
I don't know. So it's hard for me to say yes, I approve it without having a little more detail.
That's what I'm asking.
So as far as where riders could ride, we have chosen to adopt the same policy of rules of the road for adult cyclists. So preference would be that you use a bike lane first and foremost. You can ride in the roadway if it's under 25 miles per hour, and a prohibition on using sidewalks in the downtown area, which I believe is currently prohibited for cyclists, and with the opportunity to prohibit sidewalk riding in pedestrian overlays should those communities wish.
Is it geofence?
Yes, so as part of our RFP, we're asking all vendors to provide their proof of their ability to geofence and examples of geofencing programs they have in place. And once a vendor's...
Explain geofencing,
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Yes. So geofencing is a technology in which the operator, the scooter company, programs in to the communication between their system and the scooters that it's essentially an electronic fence or wall around a location. I'll use City Hall as an example. If we didn't want scooters operated in the municipal complex, we could ask the operator to program that scooters, once they hit this digital wall around the City Hall, the scooter would slow to either a complete stop. There are two options. You can go to a complete stop, so the scooter could not be operated in this area, or it would slow to just an extremely slow speed. I think it's under 5 miles per hour, making it unpleasant to ride or just untenable. And so then the users would have to take it out. And to prevent users from just abandoning the vehicle in these geofence areas, so you don't have a pileup of vehicles around your an area that you don't want e-scooters accessing. Vendors also have preferred parking areas, so they create incentives for their users to park in preferred parking zones by reducing the cost to the user. They also will penalize bad behavior, so if you do try to abandon it, one option is the way you access the scooter. You log in on an app on your phone, you create an account, has your debit card information, and you start running a tab similar to your Uber rides or the existing bike share program that we have. So in situations where a user tries to leave a scooter where they're not authorized to, they would not be able to complete their ride and close out of the program. So they would still be running a tab. So there's a financial disincentive to abandoning a scooter in a place where it should not be abandoned if there are places in the city that we wish to designate as no scooter zones.
I'm going to go to Angela, but I think it appears that there's already a methodology formulated with your committee. And as you talked about, we will put out an RFP with defined terms and already definitions. I think that will be helpful because you're explaining it, but we don't have it in front of us.
So why don't we get you a copy before we issue this of showing you exactly what's going to go out so you'll know what the parameters are.
I think it will be helpful. Okay, Angela, then Martin, are you? You parked. Okay, Angela. Tommy,
do we have anything in place as far as regulatory concerns or regulatory statutes for private users, those who have scooters who would not be utilizing the ride share? And as far as the 520 scooters that we have from Bird, how are we going to get the money that they owe us, and can we issue an injunction against them so that they can't drop any more birds in our area?
The collection can be difficult, so that's in progress. So if we don't get paid for the collection and storage,
can we sell them at some point in time?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
And so that may be all that we end up getting. That there is some regulation for private scooters, mm-hmm. so that they're not currently permitted on the streets.
Okay.
I think they're not permitted, and I'm not sure how we treat them on the sidewalks right now. Maybe we don't address them at all on the sidewalks. We have just recently permitted bicycles.
Okay.
Yeah,
we treat them like cyclists. Whatever we
issue with an RFP and a pilot program needs to be considered for e-scooters, and also we should be looking at e-bikes as a future option as well. I mean, these are all future initiatives. And if Bird doesn't pay for their storage fees, are they considered eligible to participate in the RFP?
If they pay their fee?
If they do not, are they eligible to participate in the RFP?
So I spoke with Christina Owen in purchasing today about this exact issue because it has come up, and we're including a provision in the RFP that any vendor who submits does have to be in good financial standing with the city, meaning they would have had to pay any outstanding fees or fines.
And is there
an
amount of money collecting interest?
Yes.
Daily storage
fee. It's a daily storage fee.
I know it's a daily storage fee, but is it collecting interest on the daily storage fee?
I don't think we charge interest. I think we can charge interest for the law.
We may be. Let us take a look at that. So.
Okay, maybe.
Ms. Frieda, when was the last drop? In October? for Bird?
It was sometime right before Thanksgiving.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you.
Okay, Courtney.
I just think we need to have a lot of accountability and hooks into these vendors so that they just can't get away with whatever they choose to do based on their business model. I think it's a great opportunity for the city to engage in this type of mobility, mm-hmm. but within our parameters and our rules and our guidelines so that we're not left behind holding the bag when they choose to either leave the market, leave the product, or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to take the long view on this. Well, I think it's a good opportunity again for mobility, but it needs to be on our terms and conditions.
And as Mr. Smith mentioned, we will provide a copy of the RFP that is drafted. And included in that, we do recognize that we don't want this to be overly burdensome to the city. There will be some staff involvement by default because it's in our right-of-way. We will deal with residents who want to come to the city if they have questions. But we are asking whatever vendor comes forward that they have to provide maintenance and rebalance, and they have to go collect misplaced scooters. We're trying to mimic some of the beneficial components of our bike share program, but also create a little more control in recognizing that a scooter is a lot easier to move around than a bike that has to be chained to a bike rack or some other structure.
Timelines for rebalancing, mm-hmm. timelines for collections. I mean, there's a lot that we need to put in here that we have in our control and we're not left to wonder.
Okay. All right, Tommy?
What is the age of riding these? Is it 16?
I think it's 18.
That's 16. I thought that it was
18. For well, the reason why, look, I'm not a fan of the, I don't know if I'm going to support this, but I like our pace bikes, just leave it at that. But we'll see as we get closer to it. But maybe an opportunity to provide transportation for students in school if they're 16 and older and can ride them, that maybe there's a student, like a free student card or something that they can use them to get back and forth to school. Just an idea to throw in there in the RFP. I don't know if anybody else is doing that, but... I like just bikes. I'm happy with pace bikes.
I also do like the idea that it's just a pilot, because again, if this thing fails,
we don't know.
On the street and move on. And I like the idea of more than one vendor so that we're not beholden to one, and nor our residents and guests and visitors and tourists.
Mar, you want to say anything? You good?
Okay. I'm ready to ride.
You ready to ride. Okay. Ready to scoot.
Jessica, thank you.
All right, Jessica. Thank you, Jessica.
So Mayor, I'll ask you to pull out your calendars.
Yes, sir.
At your place, and we'll talk about those.
Yes, ma'am.
So, Ms. Johnson, if you would not, I think there was some noise, if you could say that for the camera.
I would like to officially, for the record, to say that City Manager Doug Smith and team did a great job on our calendar for the upcoming year, for 2019. I think that you took into...
Do you have enough meetings? Yep, you gotta have one a month. So let me talk you through sort of what we did.
I'm not finished.
It is your birthday, right?
Is
it
yes.
your birthday?
Oh,
we can do it upstairs. Mr.
Manager, I want to say you listened to what we had to say, and thank you to my colleagues as well. Now I'm finished.
I want to echo that too. The consistency piece of a second and fourth Monday night, which is kind of like what we started with, other than when we have a holiday preceding the Tuesday night council meeting, I think it's very important for us to be able to tell constituents when there are meetings and not have to look at our calendar to figure it out. And so I greatly appreciate that. I've also asked for an add-on to when we went to the flexibility of meetings. The request for taking that 30-day language out of the charter was not included, so I would like it if we can't go, according to our charter, can't go more than 30 days without a meeting, and I'd like to have that. I mean, we have the ability to add meetings if we need to, but I'd like to have that particular language removed. It just gives us a little bit more flexibility, especially in the summer.
All
right.
Yes,
I discussed some concerns earlier about agendas getting too big and making sure that we respect people who are putting applications in for restaurants and things like that, particularly January, February, March. We only have three meetings from January to March. And you guys know I'm the person who says no meetings. So I just want to make sure that we may have to have some flexibility in there
if the planning commission agenda gets too overwhelmed, to let these people open. It's part of being a business-friendly city, and we're delaying people being able to open in some cases because of our agenda, a whole month in some cases where they're going to be waiting. My only other concern is, and I've requested this when we went to 2 retreats a year, for those that have full-time jobs and taking leave, I would request that the September retreat be on a Friday that goes into a Saturday morning, and that we can do the review of the appointed council members on a Saturday morning. That way all the staff doesn't have to be there for that, and the people that we're reviewing are getting paid big bucks, so they can come in on a Saturday and get reviewed. But maybe we could do an all-day Friday, do our dinner on a Friday night, and then come back on a Saturday morning to the review. That way, I know, Courtney, you have to take off from work too. You know, Angela's selling houses, so anyway, Saturdays are good days to show houses. But just to be flexible, since we are doing the February 1 and the September 1, maybe we could look at that option.
But I thought the February 1 was only one day anyway.
No, it's back to 2 days.
It's back to 2, okay. Yeah.
All right, so, Tommy, you were finished?
That's it.
Okay. Andrea.
I might be counting this wrong, but there are 8 of the 12 months here, we only have one formal session. I'm very concerned about that. I don't understand why.
So let me talk you through what we heard.
Okay.
Which was no third Tuesday meeting because it a conflict with St. Paul's Advisory Group. No Tuesday after a Monday holiday, so that creates some of the challenges.
I'm not sure I understand that. Why is that?
Frankly, some conversation we had in here that seemed to have consensus.
I don't have an issue with coming Tuesday after. I mean, Monday holiday, I appreciate people coming back Monday, maybe Tuesday morning, but by Tuesday night. That seems to be a lot of the issue here.
Traditionally, we just haven't done it on the Tuesday after holiday. Just traditionally.
Have not.
You can go back several years and look at calendars. And traditionally, we just haven't had Tuesday meeting after a holiday.
Okay. I just trying to figure out. I mean, I just worried that we, as Tommy said, I just don't think we have enough times to meet.
And also, we have people who we have staff who may take off on a Friday, so we have a lot of time on a, when you have a Monday holiday, you have a skeleton staff on Friday. Getting all the stuff done and then coming in from a holiday weekend, or people who may take up on a Tuesday if there's a Monday holiday as well.
So Douglas, when do we have to adopt?
I'd like to vote next week. Let me give the last two or three things just so we you asked for stay away from obviously a lot of y'all are gone NLC BML, so that generally each of those cost us, and the August recess. That's what sort of with those parameters that got us the dates that we ended up with, and the elimination of the meetings that we eliminated. And then the one thing I want to draw your attention to is that the work sessions start at 4 with the idea that we get done at 6, and that the informal sessions start at 4:30. So
I would propose putting January 22nd back on. I don't look at Martin Luther King as a traveling holiday for people, but I would say that would at least give us a one meeting. I mean, we would have almost, 7 weeks before we would have a formal meeting. That would at least put a buffer in that.
Okay. Either the 22nd or the
29th. Yeah, or we could do it at the end of the month if that's.
What about February the 19th after President's Day? So, Doug, let's add those two back. We always can revisit that if we have to.
I think the 19th is a third Tuesday.
It's a third Tuesday.
That's
not a normal.
That wouldn't be a normal day anyway. But one of the issues, too, we also have had this year, Winter, correct me if I'm wrong, but just about every work session has been a tour, right? So we really haven't had any work sessions this year, because just about every single one, we've taken that Tuesday to be a ward tour. So
Can March 5th be a flex meeting that it could turn into a regular meeting? It's a work session now, but that would give you that week back that.
I think we're getting back to bouncing around. I think we're getting back to bouncing around. When people say one of the council meetings is Tuesday, it's the second or the fourth Tuesday night. And, I mean, without having to look at a calendar,
So
we can tell there's consistency there.
As we prepare the budget.
Yeah, we have extra meetings.
Yeah, we can probably do that March 5th. And then probably can, as we get into the summer and fall, but we're probably going to need that meeting for budget preparations.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So on the 5th, we're going to do a whole meeting.
I think so.
Okay.
And also, if you have the Planning Commission sending actions that we need to act on as relates to businesses waiting to open, you know, most of those businesses will probably be ready. Yes.
And then I would also look at maybe the 12th of November. I just, again, only having one formal session in November, and then you get to December, and you have only one session.
Also, you have your legislative.
Right.
Send off that in November as well.
So I would.
So is are we going to use the 12th as a legislative? Send off day.
Mark, what do we decide about the what week? Thursday. We're going
to
do it.
We're waiting to hear back.
See,
I think you're looking at 12, 13, 14.
We'll hear back from our speaker.
So we would do that as another option would be that.
For the legislative, yes.
Okay, that's fine. I just, you know, again, planning, these folks wait for our.
And that's why a consistent schedule, I mean, to me, that's why a consistent schedule is important. If you have a consistent schedule, you can tell people what the schedule is, and they can set their expectations accordingly.
And I absolutely agree. I think the challenge is consistent schedule gets thrown off because we have BML and National League of Cities and other things that we're all going to, but that doesn't, citizens don't realize, okay, well, if we're not going to have a meeting with National League of Cities, so if we're going to say it's going to be consistent, we have to be consistent, or, you know, it's just that I think we have to be flexible. I mean, I appreciate the discussion here.
Right, and I think that also, and putting stuff on the calendar, that we have to consider going into the winter months, adding things to our calendar, while at the same time we go to our Civic League meetings and along with the other city commitments in the evening, we have to consider that when we're looking at our schedule for the fall and winter months.
As well, I mean, and even in the summer.
Yeah.
Because in the summertime, there's all kinds of things that are happening in the community that, you know, so we are, you know, required to
as well. All right, so we're going to put, we're going to have a business meeting on the 22nd of January.
Okay.
We're going to, the 5th of March would be a full business meeting. I think we get all the way to November. So the retreat, to be determined. And frankly, the retreat was a placeholder as it is for September. I'm sorry, for September. Am I hearing the retreat is a Friday? Half day Saturday. I don't know if we had consensus on that or not.
I would support that.
Okay. I don't like going out on Friday nights, but I'll go to dinner with you on Tommy on Friday.
So for drinks? September, which one are we looking at for
so
Friday?
September is the, I don't know that we have a recommendation for you. The request was to turn that 16-17, if you have a fall retreat, that it be a Friday, and I think it would have to be the probably that 20th, 21st.
We'd be done by noon on the 21st.
I'm going to commit to Friday. So you're saying Friday is all day, and then Saturday half day?
Yes, ma'am. That's what I'm hearing.
And will we do that on the 13th or the 20th?
Certainly not on Friday the 13th.
That's a new role. Maybe on
13th.
All right. And then November, we're going to hold until we get our, keep what we have for November until we get our legislative speaker confirmed.
So back to May, if I could, should we also add a formal on the 21st? Because
okay.
In May, we're only meeting one formal.
I'm sorry. Which month are you in?
Back to May.
We that's the third Tuesday, they got St. Paul's.
Oh, no. So then should we make it the 28th?
So what is this?
That's Memorial Day. That is a traveling
I'm
holiday.
I'm not coming.
Tuesday? Is it
Memorial
Day?
No, Memorial Day. I mean, it's a traveling weekend. For staff. I mean,
GS4? Tuesday, the 29th?
28th, yeah. I think what she's saying is people travel on the back on the 27th.
Or they're leaving on the 24th. You got a skeleton crew on Friday to be trying to work out a agenda. I mean, President's Day is one day. St. Paul's is another one, but I mean, I don't know. Whatever.
I'll defer to
Do whatever y'all want.
We just do a flex meeting again? Cancel it later if it's not needed.
You can always put it back on as we go through this.
Is it easier to take it off than it is to add it? I mean, is it?
What's the notice requirement? 30 days? Okay, so we got to decide by April.
No, you don't have a 30-day notice for setting a meeting? Yes, it's only supposed to be done at any meeting. So we haven't set the exact times for the January retreat yet. And so maybe we'll do that tonight or the 18th. But it's just at any meeting. There's no 30-day requirement.
Okay. Well, Mr. Manager,
you
didn't have such a
calendar.
All right, Douglas. Get your work cut out. I did not put Memorial Day back on unless I'm. What's next? All right, so that is Richard Broad is going to give you an update on recycling and the process that we've been through since we've gotten notification of the vendor's desire to terminate our contract.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Smith. Mayor and members of council, I promise this will be very short. This evening, I would like to provide an update on the current state of recycling, discuss changes to the agreement with TFC to collect and process the city's recycling, and briefly discuss with you how staff is working to find a way forward. The world market for recyclable materials has collapsed. As a result, the economic model for recycling in the U.S. has changed quite dramatically. Previously, the sale of recyclables could cover most of the cost of sorting and shipping. When the market no longer covered cost, a recycling contractor opted to end its contract with the city per the terms of our agreement with them. This is a summary of the recent events with respect to that contract we had just signed with TFC back in September of 2017. That was our second contract with them. As soon as TFC notified the city that they plan to exercise their 90-day termination clause per their contract, city staff immediately started work to put together and issue a new RFP. And the purchasing department was instrumental in really rushing that through and getting an RFP on the street. So we've since issued the RFP. We've got the bids in, and we're currently evaluating those. And TFC graciously extended us the offer to extend the old contract, the current contract, out till March 31st, 2019, which we're still operating under, so there's no interruption to resident service. So staff is currently assessing how to proceed in this challenging recycling market. We're considering several questions during this assessment. For example, is single-stream curbside recycling still a viable model for the city of Norfolk? Will the U.S. Develop its own recycling processing industry? Because again, a lot of this is caused by China tightening up on their contamination standards to which no single-stream recycling model, which the U.S. is primarily following, can meet at this time. And what can we do to eliminate contamination in the recycling collections? And what can we do to simplify recycling for our residents? So questions. That's it.
So this is a...
Andrea.
I have a question. So I want to understand, I've heard talked about, so recycling as it currently stands, the company picks it up, it's cleaned, and it's sent to China because we live in Norfolk, they get good rates for the port. But the whole market for recycling has gone bonkers. They can still recycle, it's just a lot more expensive. The other option has been waste to energy?
Wheelabrator runs the plant over by the shipyard.
But my concern with that is, as we look at our Climate Change Mitigation Commission, I don't know if that's really a good place to be going towards. So, it creates a lot more carbon emissions, and while it gets rid of the waste, it's still not particularly environmentally friendly as it relates to the other. So I hope we take that into account and we figure out I just don't know the
dollar amount what we're talking about?
It's part of the assessment. So the last thing, and I kind of glossed over it, I'm going to come back in January and get way in the weeds. It'll be a deep dive into all the this stuff, and that will be considered. Okay. And I'll bring numbers in and put a bunch of options in front of you and get your input on that. I didn't want to get to that tonight because we're still in the RFP process, so I can't really start talking about cost without violating the rules of that.
We're right in the middle of this climate change mitigation effort, so to the extent that it's not too costly, I mean, I recognize we have to weigh that, but I really hope that we maintain our recycling efforts.
Right. So this is what's coming your way, though, is exactly this conversation. And candidly, you're going to have some choices, and those choices are going to have a cost. And remember that pyramid of sort of, if you go up that pyramid, you know, to essentially reuse, and things get candidly more and more expensive. And so waste energy, which SIPSA is using with Wheel Abrader with your regular waste, is, you know, it's not the bottom of the pyramid, but it's not the top of the pyramid either. And these are going to be, candidly, hard choices. And we want the community to be aware that we're going through that process, and you all are going through that process. But I would tell you, to maintain what you had is going to be much more expensive than what you were paying. So we just want folks to understand
right.
that.
I mean, I don't know, but much more expensive translate on a per household to
right.
what?
We'll give you that. But we're in an RFP, so the RFP was to ask that question.
Okay.
So we'll have those numbers for you that say, if you want this, it's going to cost each household X. If you want this, it'll cost them
okay.
X minus whatever. So, right. And we're involved in the Norfolk Environmental Commission, correct?
Yes.
So they're in these conversations, so we'll give you some advice as well. But
okay.
Up for that. So that's the informal docket. We've got a couple items for
all closed. Right. Mr. Muse.
I move that members of council assemble informally in closed meeting on December 11, 2018 at 6:02 p.m. in the 10th floor conference room of City Hall building in the city of Norfolk for the purposes which are set out in clause 3 of subsection A of section 2.3-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended, discussion or consideration of the disposition of real property in Colonial Place. Ms. Doyle?
Aye.
Ms. Graves?
Aye.
Ms. Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Alexander?
Aye.